Hello, my friends. You've invited me in to speak with you for a few moments about the closing of churches in America. Thank you for taking time to listen to what I have to say and to talk to you about whether or not your church will become a statistic soon with a big padlock on the front door. Take a quick look at what Dr. Gary Berg is saying about this.
Sometimes when I'm out driving, I'll see a church along the roadside, and I'll wonder about the community that must live there. Sometimes I wonder about the people who live in the church, the community they have, the history of the church. And sometimes I like to look for signs of the church as its successes, how it flourishes, the quality of its life together. Sometimes I've driven down the road and I've seen a church with a for sale sign out in front, and I've wondered, what happened to that church? I mean, how did this church fail? Did the community break apart?
Massive numbers of churches are closing their doors all across America, the United States of America, where on our dollar bills we say, "In God we trust," the Christian nation. I do not want to see more churches closing. I don't want to see the padlock on any more churches. I don't want to see a for sale sign on the front door of another church. And I know you do not want that to happen to your church. Pastors are quitting the ministry in large numbers because they are becoming discouraged. And I'm sure that you don't want your pastor to leave, to quit the ministry. I'm sure you don't want to see that. Let's pause here as we begin and offer a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, this is the day that you have made. We rejoice and are glad in it. We rejoice in you always. We delight ourselves in you, Lord, because happy are those whose God is the Lord. Your mercies are new every morning. Thank you for those mercies, and that your Holy Spirit is with us just now as we discuss the topic at hand. May we be ever more aware of your presence so that your joy in each of us will be full, complete, and overflowing. Thank you for the opportunity that you have given me to share, and I commit this time to you, Father, and deposit it into your care. May your hand be on each person that has gathered here. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now, since you don't know Don Curtis, probably never heard of me, that is, unless possibly you were on one of my flights back some time ago, I want to introduce myself because it's kind of nice for you to know who it is that's talking to you about the subject that we're going to be talking about. So, first of all, I am not a nationally syndicated radio host. I am not a New York Times best-selling author. I'm just an ordinary person like all of you. I do have a flyer that I produced that I send out to some people, and in it has a little brief resume. And I'll give you a brief resume so you will get a better idea of who it is that's talking to you. Here's what this little piece says. A professional seminar leader for many years, Don brings a wealth of experience to you from a background of the unusual. A radio announcer, rodeo clown, army drill sergeant, army officer, combat pilot, war college instructor, FAA flight and classroom instructor, college teacher, airline pilot, blimp pilot, helicopter pilot, corporate executive, company owner, church leader, husband, and father. So that's me. Now, you know that I'm just an ordinary person like the rest of you. After retiring from the flying business in the year of 2000, I began doing leadership seminars for businesses all across the country. They were successful. We were able to help some businesses. We were able to help the people in some of those businesses understand some of the things that they needed to do to help that business grow and be a little bit more successful. But I traveled the country doing leadership seminars. Now, a few years back, the pastor of my church told me that 6,000 churches closed their doors in America in that year. That was the year of 2003. 6,000 churches padlocked, out of business, shut up, probably for sale. Now, I don't know how many churches there are in the United States of America, but for me, to see that many close and shut their doors is a major tragedy. So I asked myself, how do I reconcile that? I had to say, I don't know. I don't know. I've been in churches from Seattle to Miami. I've been in churches from San Diego to Boston. I've been in churches in many countries around the world. I've seen some good ones, and I've seen some not so good ones. But one thing that I know is that you and I are the reason a church will be successful or not. And I want you to understand, this has nothing to do with money. This has to do with you and I helping that church be successful. Not only the pastor, but you and I. So that's what I came to talk to you about today. This is really about leadership. You and your being a servant leader in the church where you worship. I listen to the radio a lot in my car. I listen to a lot of sermons as I drive around in my car. And over the last two or three weeks, it's been kind of unusual. I have heard a lot of sermons about what people in the church don't do and the need for Christians to step up and start doing some of the behind-the-scenes jobs in the churches. It's been kind of unusual to me to hear these things, but obviously it's becoming a little more of a problem than I even thought. Now, I don't want you to get up and run off. I'll explain as we go along, but this is a good subject, and it's a very positive subject, but I'm here to talk to you about helping keep the church, your church, from becoming a statistic. I have to tell you, I am heartsick at the prospect of so many churches closing their doors, so many pastors quitting the business. And you know what? With that statistic in mind, it may look like Satan is winning the battle. Unfortunately, he is having a great deal more success than he should be having. However, as bad as it may look, he is not winning the war. How do we know? Because you and I have the rest of the story. We know the end game. We know what's going to happen in the end. We know who is winning this war. Winning a few skirmishes, Satan is, but he is not and will not win the war. Now, after I heard this statistic, I felt like the Holy Spirit asked me to take that business leadership seminar and rewrite it and start presenting it to churches. So I started to rewrite. But first of all, I had to ask the question, why were these churches closing? I asked some pastors, I asked some retired pastors, I asked some church leaders, why were these churches closing? The answer was exactly what I hoped I would not hear, but what I expected. Too many Christians go to church either out of tradition, or to get in out of the cold, or to get in out of the heat, or to just get away from the world for a few minutes. We don't any longer, too many of us, go to church with the idea of finding a place to serve. Too many Christians today attend church and allow everyone else to do the work. We can no longer allow that to happen. Far too many Christians don't understand that we were not created to consume resources, to eat, breathe, and just take up space. And I don't want to hear of more churches closing. And I'm sure, again, you do not want your church to become a statistic and look back one day and watch someone put a padlock on the front door of your church and maybe a for sale sign up in the yard. So hopefully, over the next few minutes, I'll be able to help you understand what you can do and why you need to do what you can do. In his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, Rick Warren gives five purposes for your life. The fourth is, God designed you to make a difference with your life. Now, while many best-selling books offer advice on how to get the most out of life, that's not the reason God made you. You were created to add to life on earth, not just take from it. God wants you and I to give something back. Pastor Warren says, God's fourth purpose for your life, and it's called your ministry or service. And the Bible's very specific here, as was Jesus. And we'll talk more about ministry and service as we go along, but first let me ask you this question. What better place to add to life on earth than in that place that you worship, in that church where you sit, that place that needs you so badly, that body of believers that needs you so badly, that pastor that needs your help so badly? Not just warming a pew, but participating. In Ephesians 2:10, it is God himself who has made us what we are and given us new lives from Christ Jesus. And long ago he planned that we should spend these lives helping others. I know you help others. I know you're a good person. But do you think that God was not speaking about the local church? I believe that's exactly what he was talking about, among some other places. So let's get into the meat of this. Let's talk about leadership. And I know you're asking me, what is leadership and what does that have to do with me? All right, I will explain. First of all, leadership is a badly misunderstood term. Most of us think of the president of the company or the military commander or the person that's always standing up in front of the crowd. But most of us, until someone like me shows up, believe that in order to be a leader, you've got to be the tallest, you've got to be making the most money, you've got to be able to run the fastest, you've got to have the greatest speaking voice, or you have to have a PhD, or possibly you have to have gone to one of those 2 or 3 or 4 day leadership courses that cost $5,000, and they try to teach you how to be a leader in a few days. Let me make this statement. In the final analysis, leadership is the only advantage one business, be it a church or a business, has over another in a competitive society. Now, I realize this advantage over another is not a biblical term, but I will tell you that your church is competing with hundreds, if not thousands, of things that go on outside every day, especially on the weekends. The things that go on that keep people from coming to church, you are competing with those things, hundreds, thousands of things that go on every day outside of the church. So don't think you're not in competition with what goes on outside of your church. Now, billions of dollars are spent every year on leadership courses that try to teach you how to be a leader in a short period of time. And these courses, like I said, are a day or two or three long and very expensive. I don't believe it's possible to teach someone how to be a leader in 2 or 3 days. So I'm not going to try to teach you how to be a leader. What I will do for the next few minutes is to give you an idea of what a leader is and what is the function of a leader at church, and then let you make your own decision. Because every person alive has leadership ability somewhere inside of them. Unfortunately, in school, from grade school through high school, we're not taught to be leaders. We are actually taught to be followers. We're not taught to be self-starters. We're taught to be employees. You remember in grade school when the teacher said, get behind such and such and follow them to the lunchroom. Get behind me and follow me out to the playground. Get behind, stand here, don't move, don't say anything. That's what we're taught all the way through school. Am I not right? I think I am. So what happens when someone comes along and asks you to take a leadership position? You say, well, I'm not qualified. I'm not qualified to be a leader. You think you're not qualified to be a leader. But if you understood what real leadership is, you probably would be more qualified than you think you are. As Abigail Adams wrote long ago to Thomas Jefferson, great necessities call forth great leaders. What great necessity is there more than the church in which you worship. Now, if I really wanted to teach you how to be a leader, I'd ask you to come with me and we'd go do what I did a few years back. I'd gotten into the military and I was one of those young men who wanted to be all you could be. You know, the military says, be all you can be. And I was kind of a tough kid. I was brought up on a farm. I was raised in a military family. I'd played sports in high school and I wanted to be all I could be. So I volunteered for some of those very special schools that very few people graduate from. One of those was a leadership survival course. They took us and they dumped us into the jungle of the Philippines with a knife, a compass, and a poncho cover. If you've never been in the military, a poncho cover is just simply a kind of a tent that you throw over yourself with a hood when it rains. And I'm going to tell you what, the jungle of the Philippines is dark, it's cold, it's wet, it's hot, it's dank, it's bug infested. I spent 3 weeks in that jungle situation learning leadership, learning survival. And I'm really glad I did. But if I wanted to teach you how to be a leader, that's what we do. I'd say, okay, let's get on the plane and let's go to the jungle of the Philippines and we will spend 3 weeks and you will either be a leader. What they told us was, if you make it back to camp, you graduate from the course. If you don't make it back, well, we don't know what's going to happen to you out there in the middle of that jungle. But I'm really glad that I learned leadership. I'm glad I learned what it was about because I've been able to use that many, many times in the positions that I've been in since that time. But you know what? You and I are not here to learn that kind of leadership. We are here to discuss the Jesus type of leadership. The type of leadership that Jesus displayed was servant leadership. Servant leadership. So if you're writing this down, write servant leadership, not just leadership, because there is a great difference. And you know what? God is looking for people to use. People who are not afraid to step up. People who want to do a bit more. But maybe they don't know what they're good at. Or they don't know what needs to be done. In 2 Corinthians, in 2 Corinthians 16:9, we read these words, "The eyes of the Lord search the whole earth in order to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to Him." The eyes of the Lord search the earth for people. Did you know God has been searching for you? Do you know that your church really needs you? Not just your pocketbook. I know you know this, but do you know how it needs you? Do you know where it needs you? You know, most things don't happen overnight, and change comes slowly. However, as one by one, individuals make the conscious choice to live up to their potential, things begin to happen from deep down inside. So let me give you an example of that in just a moment, because what I want to talk to you about is you taking up the challenge of doing some of those behind-the-scenes jobs that need to be done, that possibly are not being done, that your pastor may be doing and wearing himself out. Now, I'm sure that you do not want your church, the place that you worship, to become a statistic like those 6,000 that closed. I said change takes place slowly, and here's an example. This really has nothing to do with the church, it has to do with people. This is called the Chinese bamboo tree. You plant the Chinese bamboo tree seed in the ground and you water it for an entire year and nothing pops up out of the ground. You have to water it or it'll die. You water that seed the second year, nothing pops up out of the ground. You water that seed, don't forget to water it, it'll die. You water that seed for the third year, nothing pops up out of the ground. You water that seed for the fourth year, again, don't forget to water it, it'll die. Nothing pops up out of the ground. You water that seed for the fifth year, and as my daddy used to say, lo and behold, sometime in the fifth year, in a six-week period of time, that Chinese bamboo tree grows 90 feet tall. In a six-week period of time, after waiting for 5 years, you talk about change taking place slowly? That's change taking place slowly. But change does take place, I will tell you. You know, leadership is just like getting old. It's simply a state of mind. You're only as old as you think you are. And you're only as much of a leader as you think you are, because leadership is truly a state of mind. But you know that true leadership is really being a servant. Being a servant first. You know, serving is the opposite of our natural inclination. So is being a leader. I have this, that this is very important. I want you to understand this. Most of us are interested more in serve us than in service. We like to be served. We don't like to serve. And that's a tragedy. Too many of us Christians say, I'm looking for a church that meets my needs and blesses me, not I'm looking for a place to serve and be a blessing. That's what's happening across America today. Today, thousands of churches are dying because Christians are unwilling or afraid to step up and be a leader, to step up and be a servant. They sit on the sidelines as spectators, and the body suffers. Let me say it this way, Christian brother and sister. For Christians, service is not optional. It's not something to be tacked onto your schedule if you can spare the time. Service is the heart of the Christian life. So the leadership that lurks down inside of you, that leadership that you may not think you have, is desperately needed by the body of Christ. Just ask your pastor. Each of us has a role to play, and every role is important. There's no small service to God. It all matters. Especially if you're in one of those small churches. Sometimes we who are in the smaller churches, it's more important that we step up and do some of the behind-the-scenes jobs, because there aren't enough people to do everything. And if you and I don't step up, who's going to do it? The pastor's going to do it. He's going to spend way too many hours in here doing some of the things that you and I should be doing. Now, I know that you're strapped for time. You work. You have a family. You may work and have a family, probably. You may be going to school. You may work and have a family and are going to school. You may be a single parent. You may work two jobs. You may be retired. You may have an ill loved one at home that you have to take care of. I've been in many of these situations, and I know what it takes to add responsibility at a church to your schedule. But remember this, service is the pathway to real significance. In Romans 12:5, we read this. Each of us finds our meaning and function as a part of his body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts. Some prophesy, some serve, some encourage, some contribute, some lead, some show mercy. I paraphrase that just a bit. That's what Paul said in Romans. As you and I serve together in God's family, the local church, our lives take on eternal importance. Now, this may sound a bit harsh, but it's right out of the Word of God. We are only fully alive when we are helping others. Mark wrote these words of Jesus: if you insist on saving your life, you will lose it. You've heard that. Only those who throw away their lives for my sake and for the sake of the good news, the gospel, will ever know what it means to really live. Jesus thought so much of this that he spoke to it some 5 times in the Gospels. If you aren't serving, you're just existing, because life is meant for ministry. God wants each of us to love and serve others unselfishly. And what better place than in that church where you worship regularly? The church and the pastor that need you and that talent that you have so badly. And there you sit, taking up electricity, taking up the heat or the air conditioning, eating the donuts at Sunday school, taking part in everything except the work that needs to be done. So I say this to you, don't do it any longer. Don't do it any longer. Now, I'm going to take just a few minutes and I want to show you some of the small hidden tasks that are called service tasks, leadership tasks. These are the tasks in a church that sometimes make the biggest difference. And then I want to see if you recognize anything that you could be doing, anything in your church that needs to be done, anything that may not be being done, something that your pastor may be doing. When I came to the church that I'm at currently, on Sunday mornings, we would watch the pastor in the office folding the bulletins. I said, that's not right. So we took that up on ourselves, and then another gentleman came along and he started doing it. That was one of those small little things that the pastor had to do because nobody stepped up and said, Pastor, can I do that? Or Pastor, I can do that. I can fold paper. That's the kind of things that I'm talking about. Now, before I show you the list, I want to ask you this. In your house, which light is most important in the dark of night? Let's say it's 2:00 in the morning, dark. You have to get up for whatever the reason. You're going to go down the hallway to the kitchen. Which light is most important? Is it that chandelier that hangs in the foyer of your home? Or is it that little nightlight that's plugged into the wall in the hallway? I think you know what the answer is. You know which light is the most important at that time of night when you have to go down the hallway before you can turn on the light in the chandelier in the hallway. My point is, there is no correlation between the size of the job and its significance. Now, I'm going to address significance more in a few minutes, but what I want to do now, I want to take a look at some of those behind-the-scenes jobs that have to be done in the church, just to give you an idea of some of those jobs. Okay, so let's look at some of those behind-the-scenes jobs. Let me see what 1 Corinthians 12:27 has. 1 Corinthians 12:27 says, all of you together are Christ's body, and each one of you is a separate and necessary part of it. Okay? Now, let's go through some of the behind-the-scenes jobs. I've listed some on the board here. First thing is prayer. Okay? That's not a behind-the-scenes job, but I want you to understand that if you can do nothing else, you can pray for your church and your pastor and the people that are doing the jobs that need to be done. Let's talk about folding those bulletins. Somebody has to fold the bulletins. You might ask the pastor, do you need help folding the bulletins? How about helping with communion? Somebody has to fill those little cups. Somebody has to break up the bread. Somebody has to put it all together. You might say, Pastor, can I help fill up the communion glasses? Visitor cards. There's visitor cards in the back of the seats. Somebody has to put those in there. That could take you 15, 20 minutes a week if you could help out and do that. Flowers. Somebody has to put the flowers together. Somebody has to pick up the flowers. You might ask if there's something you could do. Usher. Every church needs additional ushers. They need standby ushers. That wouldn't take any time if you're going to be there anyway. It might be something that you could do. How about welcoming people at the front door? How about working on the bulletin boards, helping the person that does the bulletin board. You might have some talent there. How about just picking up things in the parking lot? How about just monitoring the parking lot? How about the rose bushes? Does your church have rose bushes out in front? You may have rose bushes at home and you like to work with roses. You might come and trim the rose bushes if your church doesn't have a gardener that does those kind of things. Always need a little help in the kitchen. Yes, I know it can be kind of a messy job, but you have a special event. You might say, who's handling all that? Can I help out in the kitchen? How about special events? Your church has special events. Volunteer to just be part of it. What can I do when we have this special event? Sound system. You may have some talent in that area. Maybe you can help with your sound or your video equipment, whatever it is. How about phone calling? Maybe you can't do some of these other things, but you know what? I'll bet you could be on the phone calling some of the shut-ins, calling some of the people that haven't been there in a while. I'll bet you could do that. Ask your pastor about that. You have a food pantry in your church? They might need help with that. How about the church bus? You may be able to drive the church bus, or maybe you can work on the church bus. Maybe you've been a mechanic, or you could help clean the church bus. All of these things are so necessary. If you're not doing them, who's going to do these? How about Sunday school? Oh, we need Sunday school teachers. You could be an assistant Sunday school teacher. You don't have to know all about the Bible. You don't have to know much of anything. Can you read? You could read stories to those little kids in Sunday school. Be an assistant Sunday school teacher. How about singing in the choir? Maybe you say, I can't sing. Can you hum? That's all right. They just probably need a few more people in the choir. How about cleaning the church? You know what? You may come and just wipe off the windowsills. You may come and wipe off the seats. Maybe come and wipe off the altar. Those things need to be done. If you're not doing them, your pastor's probably doing them. Somebody needs to do them. Maintenance around the church. If you're retired, that's a great way to keep busy a little bit. There's always maintenance that needs to be done around a church, and it can really be expensive. Your church could use that kind of help. Then I have written down here, I hope you can see that, it says ask. A-S-K, ask. Just ask the pastor. Ask your church administrator. Ask the Sunday school teacher, is there something that I can do to help? I know the church needs help. They may say, no, we're totally taken care of, but I'll probably venture to say that they're not. And then down here, it says pray in very bold letters, because I believe that everything we do must be surrounded in prayer. And prayer must be the foundation to everything that we do. Prayer has to be the foundation. So if you can do nothing else, why don't you set aside a time every week? Let's say Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock, you're at your home, and you're going to pray for your church. You're going to pray for those people that are doing the work at the church. You're going to pray for the pastor. You might call three or four other people who can't do a lot of these other things. Maybe they're shut in. Maybe they just don't. They have a loved one at home or whatever it is that I said. Ask them. Let's pray at 7 o'clock on Wednesday evening. You're at your home. I'm at my home. He's at his home. She's at her home. Let's pray. We're all together. The Bible says, if two or three of you are gathered together in my name. I don't know if that means you all have to be gathered together around the altar or if you're gathered together on the telephone. But pray. If that's what you can do, if that's all you can do, pray. But this is just some of the behind-the-scenes jobs that every church has to have in order to be successful, in order to keep the doors from closing. Again, all of you together are Christ's body, and each one of you is a separate and necessary part, right out of the Word of God. I've been a pilot since 1967, and I know that it would be impossible to operate whatever aircraft it is that I'm operating without those people that you very seldom see, the mechanics, the air traffic controllers, the weather people. I would not want to be flying around in an aircraft if I didn't have a mechanic taking care of it. I don't know how to maintain it, but they do. But you never see those people. I really, you know, everybody thinks that being the pilot up in the cockpit is the most glamorous part of flying. And I have to tell you, there is some glamour to it. But I would not want to be taking you and 149 other people from where you live to some other part of the country without those people that do the behind-the-scenes jobs. Those people at the counters, those mechanics again, those air traffic controllers, all of those people that you don't see are the people that make the thing hum like a well-oiled machine. Without them doing those jobs, I wouldn't get into that airplane, and I hope you wouldn't get into it. It's those people, the behind-the-scenes people, that make it a success. Now, let me give you something that you might relate to a little bit better. Have you been to a restaurant that maybe you went to this restaurant 10, 15 years ago, and you came back to that restaurant, and you noticed, boy, you know, the place doesn't look as good. The waitress is kind of snarly. The place isn't as clean. There's a lot of cigarette smoke in here. You order something to eat and it's not as good. I'll tell you why. It's because management, leadership, makes all the difference there is in a restaurant. You can walk into a restaurant and in a few minutes you can tell whether there's good leadership in that restaurant or not. You had great leadership back there 10, 15 years ago when you went in. The leadership is gone now. The same is true, my friends, of the church. Walk through the doors of a church on the day of worship and you can tell in a minute if that church is filled with a group of leaders, servants, or people that are there because they just wanted to take a break from the outside world. Remember the statement that I made a little earlier? I'm looking for a church that meets my needs and blesses me, not I'm looking for a place to serve and be a blessing. Remember, service is the pathway to real significance. Trust me, my friends, God put leadership within you. You only need to discover it, and you will if you find a need and fill it. You will discover it. And let me just say it this way. If you really care about that pastor and the body of believers that you worship with. We used to take young men and run them through what's called basic training. Any of those of you that have been in the military, you'll never forget basic training. Now, notice I said young men. Because back in the 60s, when we did this, the women had their own basic training down in Alabama. And so I only worked with men. But we would take these young men, and in 8 weeks, many of them would discover things within themselves that they never realized that they had. They would discover leadership within themselves that they never dreamed that they had. They never thought that they had any leadership ability. Then we trained combat pilots, and the same thing happened. Many of these young people would discover things within themselves because of the training, because of the time that we spent working with them, because sometimes someone has to help you discover and then recognize, first of all, what leadership is, then help you bring it to the surface. And I'll tell you again, there is leadership within every one of you. But you first have to develop the heart of a servant. Every one of those young people that we ran through basic training, we ran through pilot training, the ones that developed leadership always stepped up to do the little extra things. They found out that they were a servant first. You'll not become a leader unless you are first a servant at heart. Now, I've been using the term leader and the term servant more or less together. So, which am I really talking about? I use them together because I think they are the same. As I said, I don't think you can be a leader unless you're a servant. The servant leaders are those who are doing the behind-the-scenes jobs. They keep the church running like that well-oiled machine. They are greeting people at the door. They're the ushers. They're running the sound. They're teaching the Sunday school classes. They're taking the offering. They're praying with people at the altar. I don't believe there should ever be a time when someone comes to the altar and two or three people don't come and pray with them. They're watching the babies. They're helping in the church grounds. And many more of the tasks that we listed up here on the board. These are the servant leaders. Did you get that? Those who first are servants. Now, it does not matter your station in life, your position on the corporate ladder, your income or the lack thereof, how educated you are or not, whether you're at the top or the bottom, whether you're tall or short, whether you can run fast or you can't run at all. Because leadership is a state of mind, nothing else. Not something you need to be afraid of, because it comes from right here, the heart. Why do some people get promoted and others don't? Why do some people just seem to have why do some people just seem to have what it takes and others don't? These are the ones that have taken up the challenge, and they live by, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And they take that very seriously. These are the ones that have decided to step up and do a little bit extra to do what the followers are not willing to do, to be an integral part of the team, to go the extra mile. This place that you worship is a team effort. These are the ones that realize that leadership's not hard. It's nothing to be shunned. And it's those that live by Mark 10:43, where Jesus said, whoever will be great among you shall be your minister. That's the King James. Here's what the NIV says. Whoever wants to be great among you must become your servant. So, take a look around. I know you can see some folks in your church, in your congregation, that are real true servants. They're leaders, they're servants. They're ministers, they're leaders, they're servants, they're servant leaders. Take a look at your pastor. Your pastor is a minister, a servant, a leader. All three of those. And I'll bet that he's working a whole lot harder than he needs to be working and should be working, especially if you happen to be in one of those smaller churches. Because too many Christians today are not willing to step up and take some of the load off. Too many Christians don't think they have what it takes to do some of those behind-the-scenes jobs that we listed earlier. But you're wrong. You do have what it takes, but you have to have the want to. Now, I hope I'm not being too hard on you here. I just want to emphasize my point, because I believe that my point is very, very important, and I hope you take it to heart. Do you really understand that Jesus measures greatness in terms of service, not status? God determines your greatness by how many people you serve. And you know, this is so contrary to the world's idea of greatness, and we even have a hard time understanding it, much less practicing it. Again, Jesus said, whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. Matthew 20:27. Listen to this, okay? This is not out of the Bible, but unfortunately, it is the facts of life. This story that follows is about four people named Everybody, Somebody, Anybody, and Nobody. There was an important job to be done, and everybody was asked to do it. Everybody was sure that somebody would do it. Anybody could have done it, but nobody did it. Somebody got angry about that because it was everybody's job. Everybody thought anybody could do it, but nobody realized that everybody blamed somebody when nobody accused anybody. That, my friends, unfortunately, is the facts of life. Thousands of books have been written on leadership, but few on servanthood. Because the term servant means that you have to do the dirty jobs. There's a program on television called The Dirty Jobs. You've probably seen it. You may have seen it. This guy does some really dirty jobs, and there are some dirty jobs out there. I was brought up on a farm. We had goats at one time. We had dairy cows at one time. What do you do when you're finished milking the dairy cows? You clean out the barn. You talk about a dirty job. It has to be done. Then you take that dirty and you put it in the manure spreader and you get it behind the tractor and you take off out through the field, and that auger goes around and around and around and throws that stuff all over your head, all over your shoulders, all over the field. You talk about a dirty job, but it had to be done. You could not go back in the barn. You couldn't. My dad wouldn't let us leave the barn until the barn was clean. It also kind of means that we have to be subservient to someone else. And most of us want to lead, not follow, even if we don't know how to. We still don't like to follow. So you know what happens? Too many of us just stay out of the way. Now, I'm not talking about stepping up and leading the congregation. I'm not talking about stepping up and taking over the music or directing choir or even teaching a Sunday school class, if that's not what you think you can do. But I am talking about becoming a more integral part of the team, because your pastor needs more team members. The pastor cannot have too many people on the team helping out. Cannot. I've been in combat more times than I'd like to remember. I cannot imagine going into combat all alone. No one to cover my back. No one to be the spotter. In that Cobra helicopter that I used to fly, if you don't know what that is, well, the Army has helicopters. We call them the Huey. You've probably seen a picture of those. Then they have a Cobra. It's a real thin, just nothing but a gun platform. And I don't want to offend anybody talking about war here, but it's just a gun platform where the gunner sits in front, the pilot sits in the back. I would not want to have been flying that aircraft in combat without that gunner, that spotter in the front, because my job was to fly the aircraft and make sure we stayed out of the way of the other guy and that we went to where we needed to go while he did the spotting, while he fired the weapons at whatever it needed to be fired at. Now, I had the opportunity, I could fire the weapons, but to fly and fire at the same time, not real easy. I would not have wanted to be in combat in that helicopter without that spotter to do the job that he did. I got the credit because I was the captain, I was the aircraft commander, but again, he was the behind-the-scenes guy that did a great deal of the work. Nor would I want to be flying that airplane again, filled with 150 passengers in the back across the country, without those people that you don't see. They don't talk a lot about the co-pilot. They don't talk a lot about the mechanics, the air traffic controllers, the weather people that keep us out of trouble when we take you at 35,000 feet and drive you across the country. The behind-the-scenes people are the people that made me successful. I would not want to be out there doing that without those people. I live just a few miles from the Nike Corporation, and I like Nike's motto, just do it. Because you know what? To me, the just do it person is one of those who everyone can count on to be doing a little bit extra. To be on time, to be picking up discarded papers in the parking lot, to opening the door for others, to asking, is there anything that I can do? That's the just do it person. I like those kind of people. And they're usually people who display these types of attributes. Now, I want to go through this with you. This is really important. When I was doing leadership seminars for the business community, I used this. There are actually 60 attributes on this list. It says up here, you probably can't read all this, it says, to be a leader, you must be, do, and have all of these attributes. I'm going to run down the list and just read a few of them for you. honest, organized, optimistic, self-starter, focused, team player, common sense, diligent, resourceful, sober, that's always nice, caring, sincere, passion, vision, courage, authoritative, communicator, creative, good listener, integrity. Integrity. I just read a few of the 60, but what I want you to see is, what I want you to understand is, that all of the 58 are surrounded by honesty and integrity. Honesty and integrity are the two things that are so very important to anybody that steps up to be a leader. You need to have all the rest of these, and many of you, most of you probably do. But I want you to know that when I was doing this for the business community, I got some oohs and ahs when I read this whole list to them, because unfortunately, in our business world today, we don't have a lot of honesty, and that is very unfortunate. Here's what I'll say to you. When everything else is gone, what do you have left? Your integrity. So, take a look at the list again. Honesty and integrity surround everything else that we do and that we're about. Honesty and integrity. You know why? Because someone will be watching you. Now, I don't mean the pastor's going to be sneaking around watching you, or they're going to have these cameras on the wall. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about someone is watching you in your whatever you do. Some little child or some other person, they're watching you. So you must display the honesty and integrity. When I was doing these leadership seminars, I had the opportunity to meet and work with Zig Ziglar a couple of times. You may have heard of him. And one of his favorite sayings is, you can have everything in life you want if you help enough others do what they want or get what they want. You can have everything in life you want if you help enough others get what they want. I believe that. As a flight instructor, I've seen that many, many, many times over. And I like what Zig said, you know, but you can have, but I like to change it and say, I can have. Because it's real easy to point the finger at other folks and say, hey, you get up and do one of these. Hey, you can have all of this. But it's sometimes hard for us to say, I can do it. I can have it. So I like to change it and say, I can have everything in life I want if I help enough others get what they want. Can you say that with me? I can have everything in life I want if I help enough others get what they want. Good. Thank you. Let's say you decided to become an airline pilot. You may never have any desire to fly, but let's just say you decided to become an airline pilot. I did that once. I came out of the Army, and I decided I wanted to be an airline pilot. I'd been flying for a number of years. I liked it. But I soon realized that I'd been flying mostly helicopters. I flew some fixed wing, but I'd been flying mostly helicopters. So I needed to do some upgrading. I needed to get some different kinds of experience. I needed to fly some different kinds of airplanes. Very, very expensive. Probably would have cost me about $100,000 to get to where I needed to go. So what did I do? I became a flight instructor. I started teaching people how to fly. Because here's what happens when you're a flight instructor. He rents the airplane. He pays me to fly with him. I get to log the time, write it in my logbook. I get the experience in the airplane. I would teach another person who would want to fly a different kind of an airplane. He rented it. He paid for it. He paid me to help him. I got the time. I got the experience. We upgraded to a different kind of airplane, twin-engine airplane, turbo-powered airplane, jet-powered airplanes. They paid for it. I got to teach them. I got the credit for it. That's how I got to where I needed to go. I helped them get... There's a lot of people that want to learn how to fly. There's people that want to be airline pilots, but they have to have somebody help them get along the way. So I helped them get to where they wanted to go, or at least get a good start, and it got me to where I wanted to go. So that's exactly how we do it. And I will tell you, it's all about attitude. Because the things that you do today that you don't have to do will determine what you will be and what you will have when you no longer are able to do anything about it. That's attitude. As Viktor Frankl said, everything can be taken from a man but one thing. What alone remains is the ability to choose one's attitude in a given set of circumstances. Trust me, my friends, attitude is so very important. The military motto is, my mission, my men, myself. My mission, my men, myself. To continuously put the mission and others before oneself takes a committed attitude. To continuously do that. That kind of attitude is critical no matter where you are, at home, at work, in the military, at school, at play, and at church. No matter where you are, it is critical. Listen to this from the book titled No Excuse. This was written by a friend of mine, Jay Riffenberry, and this is what he says in this book. Get rejuvenated by elevating your attitude and enthusiasm. Attitude and enthusiasm are like static electricity. They can rub off and cling to someone else. Attitude is your first indicator for success, while enthusiasm helps you sustain it. Dr. Norman Vincent Peale wrote a great book called Enthusiasm Makes the Difference. Your elevated attitude and enthusiasm can produce seemingly magical results at home, work, play, or wherever you go. They do make a difference. Elevate your attitude and enthusiasm, and you'll open up the exceptional things that go on around you every day. Open your eyes to the remarkable opportunities that are out there for people with elevated attitudes and enthusiasm. Elevate your attitude and enthusiasm, and you will be well on your way to becoming happier and more successful. You'll be better able to make a difference. From the book, I'm not selling the book, from the book titled, No Excuse. Very, very good book. My wife often says, Don, there is no excuse for you. You do some things that are just so absolutely silly. There's no excuse for you. You know, and I'm sure that you've run into people a time or two that do things that are so silly. A friend of mine says, some people ought to have to wear a sign that just says, stupid. Now, I don't go quite that far. You may know who I'm talking about. But he says, in order to stay away from those people, they should have to wear a sign that says, stupid. Because there's just no excuse for their actions. Absolutely none. That reminds me of a story that reminds me of a situation that I got into once. When I stopped flying in front of the airplane, I was doing these seminars, so I was flying in the back, of course, with all the passengers. And, you know, it used to be before 9/11 that you could, if you had a flight at the airport, you could get out there a half hour early and check in and walk to the gate and get on the airplane and go. Well, not anymore. You now have to be there 2 hours early, and sometimes 3 hours early. So I used to take that 6:05 flight out of the Portland airport time after time after time after time, pretty near every week for a long period of time. Well, after 9/11, you would get on the airplane. You would, if you had that 6:05 flight, you had to be at the airport at 4:05, which meant you had to leave your house at 3:05, which meant you had to get up at 2:05. Well, why even go to bed? Well, you'd try. But this one night, I couldn't go to sleep. So I just got up. I went on out to the airport. I got settled in. I like to read the Wall Street Journal when I fly, so I picked up a Wall Street Journal. Fortunately, I was flying first class. Normally, when you fly first class, you got that great big wide seat, and you would think that the people sitting around you were somewhat intelligent, because most of them probably have a little more money, you know. But one thing that I just cannot understand: have you gotten on an airplane and sat down in a seat? You have your arm on the armrest. The other person next to you has their arm on the armrest. You're touching elbows, and for 4 hours, that person never speaks to you, never acknowledges that you're there. That happens on airplanes all the time. Well, I got on board. I sat down. The gentleman next to me never acknowledged I was there, didn't look up. I always say, "Well, good morning. How you doing?" I scared the poor guy to death. But anyway, I got in. I got settled. We took off. I was reading the Wall Street Journal, which I really like to do. We climbed up. We leveled off. I was really getting kind of sleepy because I just had not been able to sleep at night that night before. I was really getting tired, and so I thought, well, you know what? I better rest here. I don't sleep well on an airplane, but I was at least going to rest my eyes. So I folded up the Wall Street Journal. Now, I never put anything in that little packet in behind the seat in front of you. If you want to know why, I'll tell you sometime. You never know what the person flying before you put in that little seat, and the cleaners don't often clean it out. You may stick your book in there and come out with somebody's melted chocolate candy bar on it. You don't want to put anything in there. So I never did put anything in there. So I folded up my Wall Street Journal, laid it on my lap, and I got to thinking, if this thing falls on the floor, the stewardess is going to pick it up, or, you know, somebody's going to step on it, and I don't want that to happen. So I unbuckled my seatbelt. I stood up. I put it on the seat. Pardon me. I put it on the seat, and I sat back down. I buckled my seatbelt, and I laid my head back, and I was resting. And pretty soon, this gentleman next to me tapped me on the elbow, and he says, I looked at him, he says, "You reading that?" And I said, I started to say, I couldn't say what I wanted to say. I wanted to say, "Do you have a sign on the front of you that says stupid? I'm a Christian. I have to be nice." So I looked at him and I says, "What was that you said?" He said, "You reading that?" And I thought to myself, okay, this is one of those people that really needs a sign. But I'm going to be nice, but he's going to get exactly what he deserves. I'm going to just give this guy the answer that he deserves. So I unbuckled my seatbelt, I stood up, I turned the page, I sat back down, I buckled my seatbelt, and I looked at him and I said, "I'm doing the crossword puzzle." Yes, you see, it's all about attitude. Sometimes we really have to control our attitude, because attitude is everything. I help others, and it helps me. And it's absolutely no different in the church that you attend. You know, as I've lived my life after high school, taking a few different jobs and trying to get through college, it took me 5 years to get a 2-year college degree. So I'm not a highly educated person. But becoming a rodeo clown, now there's an occupation for you. Then I was a radio announcer for a period of time before I got called into the Army. being an Army officer, going through our officer candidate school, going through flight school, 2 tours in Vietnam, 1 as personal pilot to the Deputy Commanding General of Troops, flying and teaching flying since 1967. I've learned that skill is only 15% of the equation. Attitude is 85% of success. Did you hear me? Success is not all skill. In fact, success at whatever you set your mind to is only 15% skill. Why do you think we were able to take a young Vietnamese man who had never been in an airplane or a helicopter, who had probably never even ridden in a car. Probably the most mechanical thing he had ever seen was a bicycle, and we were able to teach this young man how to fly a helicopter. I'll tell you why. Because we spent time working first on his attitude toward what he was going to be doing. Attitude was what allowed this young man who had never been in an airplane, probably most mechanical thing he'd ever seen was a bicycle, to become a pilot. I have taught people to fly, people from all over the world, to fly all kinds of different aircraft. And every one of them that made it through the course had an I can do it attitude. So again, there are many things that need to be done at the church where you worship. You may not think you have the skill to accomplish them, but with the right positive attitude and a heart of a servant, you can do it. You need to do it. Remember Nike? Just do it. With Jesus on your team, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You know what Moses, or you know what God said to Moses when Moses started arguing and, what I say, whining to God about his lack of leadership ability? God said, I will help you speak and teach you what to say. And the same God reigns today. And he is asking you to go and help out. So what are you waiting for? Stop arguing and whining to God. Listen, my friends, God gives every believer spiritual gifts to be used in ministry. In Ephesians 4:6, I'm just going to use my notes on this. Ephesians 4:6, Christ has generously divided out his gifts to us. 1 Corinthians 12:1, it is the one and only Holy Spirit who distributes these gifts. He alone decides which gifts each person should have. 1 Corinthians 12:7, a spiritual gift is given each of us as a means of helping the entire church. When we use our gifts together, we all benefit. If others don't use their gifts, you get cheated. And if you don't use your gifts, they get cheated. Okay, we're coming to the end of this session, but I just want to make a couple more statements before we take a break here. I really hope you're getting the point. Again, I hope I'm not being too hard on you. I hope we're leading up to helping you understand some of the things that need to be done, because you do have a gift. There is a place for you as a leader. Your church needs leaders, servants, ministers, servants who are leaders, who minister in many different ways, ministers who serve because they have discovered the leadership within. Your church needs behind-the-scenes leaders. Not more people on the platform necessarily, although they may need those too. But remember the list that I put up. Did you see anything that you might consider? Just think about it a little bit. You are valuable to your church, and your church needs you, and your pastor needs you. Let me close this session with this. This is just a cute way to end. Has really nothing to do with what we're talking about, but it's written by a friend of mine, Valerie Cox. It's called The Cookie Thief. A woman was waiting at an airport one night with several long hours before her flight. She hunted for a book in the airport shop, bought a bag of cookies, and found a place to drop. She was engrossed in her book but happened to see that the man beside her, as bold as could be, grabbed a cookie or two from the bag between, which she pretended not to see to avoid a scene. She read, munched cookies, and watched the clock as the gusty cookie thief kept diminishing her stock. She was getting more irritated as the minutes ticked by, thinking, if I wasn't so nice, I'd give him a black eye. With each cookie she took, he took one too. With only one left, she wondered what he'd do. With a smile on his face and a nervous laugh, he took the last cookie and broke it in half. He offered her half as he consumed the other. She snatched it from him and thought, oh, brother. This guy not only has nerve, but he's also rude. Why, he didn't even show any gratitude. She had never known when she'd been so galled, and sighed with relief when her flight was called. She gathered her belongings and headed for the gate, refusing to look back at the thieving ingrate. She boarded the plane and got settled in her seat, then sought her book, which was almost complete. As she reached in her bag, she gasped with surprise. There was her bag of cookies right before her eyes. If mine are here, she moaned with despair, then the others were his, and he was trying to share. Too late to apologize, she realized with grief that she was the rude one, the ingrate, the thief. I'll see you after the break. Okay, here we are again. Thank you for staying. I appreciate it, and thank you for giving some thought, I hope, to what I've had to say about you and your local church and your pastor, about becoming a leader, a servant. Did you zoom it? Okay. All right, so I'm going to start over. Okay, here we are again. Thank you for staying, and thank you also for, I hope, giving some thought to what I had to say in the first hour about you and your church and your pastor. About becoming a servant, and helping to ensure that your church does not become a statistic, because without your help, that could happen. You don't want to see your church turned into a museum, because too many Christians just stand by and watch the parade and don't participate. And that's a big part of the reason why those churches that close their doors. The body of Christ needs you. And not just warming a pew, not just taking up electricity. You attend worship services to help you grow, right? And when you grow, you don't want to just grow halfway, right? You want to grow to maturity, right? Only participation in the full life of the church builds spiritual maturity. It builds spiritual muscle. In Ephesians 4:16, we read this: from him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love, as each part does its work. Who are the parts? You and I. What are the supporting ligaments? You and I. Remember, 6,000 churches closed their doors in 1 year in the United States of America. How many will close next year? Too many. And again, I maintain that a large number of those churches closed because too many Christians sat on their other ends and watched a pastor work himself into the ground, work his fingers to the bone until he could no longer keep up the pace. And he either left that church or he quit the ministry. Don't let your church become a statistic, please. You know, over 50 times in the New Testament, the phrase one another or each other is used. We are commanded to love each other, pray for each other, encourage each other, admonish each other, greet each other, serve each other, teach each other, accept each other, honor each other, bear one another's burdens, submit to each other, and be devoted to each other. This is what's called biblical membership. Those are your family responsibilities, and God expects you to fulfill them through the local fellowship. That place where you worship on a regular basis, your church. Now, I've discovered the reason that many Christians do not participate in the jobs at their local church. I think I know why. Because there are too many good television programs, and we spend too much time watching television. Did you know that Americans watch an average of 7 hours of television a day? TV has a way of possessing us if we're not careful. My wife and I had to struggle with this when our last child left home. We have four. The youngest one left home, and we'd worked hard for many years. So we weren't going to soccer games and basketball games and all the things that the young ones do, so we started to rest more. And one thing that happened, we found ourselves watching a lot more television. We were sitting in front of the television in the evening, resting. I like to watch the news. So we would sit down sometimes at 5:30. Then we wanted to watch the news at 11 o'clock. So we would still be sitting there watching the news at 11 o'clock. 5:30 to 11:30 is how many hours? Do that 4 or 5 times a week, and your life's going to pass you by as you rest from your life. We were not reading. We were even, though, becoming aggravated at the silly programs that play, because I don't know if you know it or not, but TV programs are written for an 8th grade level. Should I say that again? An 8th grade level. Besides, we were not reading the Bible much anymore. We weren't reading anything much anymore. TV was helping us rest, or we thought so. But it was taking us away from what was most important. And you and I have to be very, very careful of that, because our archenemy, the prince of this world, will fight hard to keep us from praying and spending time in the Word of God. Because he knows that God provides prayer as a weapon to combat sin and slothfulness. And he also knows that he can keep us from advancing the kingdom, as does spending time in the Word. Satan will do everything in his power to keep you from spending time in the Word. Did you know that if you read 20 minutes a day, you would read 20 books a year? That's 18 more books than the average American reads. Do you realize that if you read the Bible 20 minutes a day, what it would do for you? Just 20 minutes a day. Every Christian leader, whether up in front or behind the scenes, must spend quality time in the Word of God. Must spend quality time in the Word of God. And I believe also reading some of the fine books written by some of our Christian authors. just a few minutes every day. If you don't eat every day, where does your strength come from? If you don't feed yourself on the Word of God every day, where does your spiritual strength come from? My friend, if you think you can battle Satan and his demons all alone without the Word of God as your shield, you just go ahead and try. You just go ahead and try or continue trying. And I will guarantee you, the minute you step up and take one of these jobs, Satan, his demons, will jump on you with both feet. So, do it this way. If what I say today is inspiring you to seek any of the jobs, no matter how insignificant you think it is, at your local church, and if you're inspired to begin helping out, then first, make a commitment to get into the Word of God every day. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, an hour, whatever you can do. I use this little book called Our Daily Bread. I like it because it has one for every day. It has a scripture. Then it has a little scenario written by an author that's a respected author. And it has a little saying down at the bottom. To do this, and I'm not promoting this book, I just use it. To do this takes me 5 to 10 minutes. Now, a lot of times in the morning, I'm in a hurry. But 5 to 10 minutes, this is a great help to me. I do it every single day. If you're not willing to abide, as the scripture admonishes us to do, then don't step up and take any of the jobs at your church. Satan will slap you upside the head and do everything he can do to defeat you in your weakened state. Remember when Jesus fasted for 40 days? Satan didn't come along in the first 10, 15, 20. He waited until the last few days, I think. Jesus was weak, tired, probably frustrated. Can you imagine being out in that desert for 40 days? That's when Satan comes. Companies, families, service organizations, the military, even churches are leadership driven. And let me say it again. Leaders come from people who have the heart of a servant first. It is somewhere down inside there, trust me. And again, you who are leaders at heart, you don't have to be the most educated. You don't have to be the tallest, making the most money, be in the highest position, have a PhD. But you must consider yourself successful. Mentally successful, psychologically successful. Try to say that 10 times very fast. And spiritually successful. You must consider yourself mentally, psychologically, and spiritually successful. And you absolutely cannot be in a situation where you are conducting yourself outside of the church in a manner that is less than spiritual. Possibly telling lies, stealing in some way or another, watching pornography on the internet, in an adulterous affair. You cannot be involved in any of these and anything else that you know in your heart is wrong where the Bible and your spiritual life are concerned. Now, if you think all this is new, then think again. In 1934, Ordway Teed said this, "On every hand today, the cry for more and better leaders." 1934. In 1984, Peter Wagner offered this insight. If churches are going to maximize their growth potential, they need people who are strong leaders. And then he goes on to say, the number and quality of leadership has a direct impact on the success or failure of a church, as does the character of the leader. A critical issue in the church today is that we have often failed to recognize character as a prerequisite for leadership. We need to understand that only out of a transformed heart, that of a servant first, can grow a godly leadership manner that will get things done while helping to transform lives in the process. Christ-like leaders, servants, seek out tasks that need done in the local body and seek out others to mentor into leadership. Servant leaders as well, and not just for the purpose of having enough help. It is to provide the right kind of leader servants to give direction to the body of Christ, your local church. Here's a question that I asked in my leadership seminars. If I were the other person, would I want me for a friend? Well, let me say it this way. If I were your pastor, would I want you for a parishioner? Is your interest in being successful or significant? If you are significant, you will be successful. If you have any interest in being successful and seeing your local church stay successful, then become significant or more significant. Become a servant. And again, to do this, sometimes it takes doing the little jobs, the little behind-the-scenes things, those jobs that no one sees, but are so very important to the success of your church and the longevity of your pastor. Sometimes you may have to begin doing something to advance the success or significance of your church so that others will follow. I found that in some of my many adventures in 1987 when Pan Am went out of business. I got caught in that going out of business thing. I found myself without a job. And fortunately, though, I was able to purchase half of a fixed base operation. Now, if you don't know anything about flying, a fixed base operation is where you have airplanes, maybe helicopters, you have a maintenance shop, you do charter work, which means you can rent the airplane, I will fly you to some place here, we teach flying and those kind of things. So I was able to buy in with a gentleman that owned a couple airplanes. I owned 2 airplanes, we leased a few more, we ended up with 11 airplanes and 1 helicopter, had a good business going, had a nice maintenance shop, but we needed a couple of contracts to ensure that the rent was paid on an ongoing basis, because if the weather got bad, you couldn't teach much flying. Maybe people didn't bring their airplanes in to be repaired periodically. So we got a contract with 2 funeral homes. And my business partner knew all about this. I was kind of young in that business. I hadn't been around the fixed base operation area much. I'd been flying the bigger ones. And so he told me that we now had a contract, called it a fly the dead contract. Now, I don't mean to be crass, but when a person will pass away, a lot of times they will pass away in another city, their family will want them transported to a different city than where they passed away, maybe bring them back home for the funeral. Well, so we had that contract to go to the city, bring them back, or take them to wherever they wanted to go. So my business partner said, okay, Don, you need experience. I wanted to be chief pilot and chief flight instructor for this particular flight operation that my business partner and I had. In order to do that, I needed, again, to gain some experience in the smaller airplanes, in doing some of the local flying and those kind of things. I'd been kind of out of that business for a while. So he said, okay, Don, I've got this mission for you. You take this aircraft, it's called a Piper Lance. Those of you that fly may know what that is. It's a little six-place airplane, has a big wide door on the side. You take the seats out, and there's a room in the back that's a perfect size to fit a casket. So he said, I want you to fly up to such and such an airport, about an hour, hour and a half away, and I want you to pick up this person that's deceased and bring them back here. So I got in the airplane. I flew up there. I landed at a little country airport. Hardly anybody there. There wasn't any tower, nothing. I brought the airplane up and I parked it. No one around. Pretty soon I saw this old blue Chevy pickup, one of those, I think, 1952 types that every farmer has, coming down the road. And the man pulled up and he started backing up toward the airplane. And I looked and I thought, well, I don't see a casket. But what I did see, to my surprise, was over the gate of the truck, the back gate of the truck, was 2 feet. Two large feet. And I got to thinking to myself, oh no, was I supposed to bring the casket? I don't have the casket. So the man backed up and he stopped. He got out of his pickup and I walked up to him and I said, are you here for me to haul that person? He said, that's my brother. You're to take him to the city. And I said, oh my goodness, did I forget to bring the coffin? He said, I ain't got no coffin. Well, fortunately, in the airplane, there was what we call a gurney, which was just a stretcher rolled up in the corner. So I got the stretcher out. He and I picked up the deceased gentleman, long, large gentleman, not big and heavy, but probably 6 feet, 6 or 7. We put him on the stretcher. We opened the doors. We put him in the airplane. Now, you don't lay a deceased person on their face. You always lay them on their back. And when we put him in the airplane, we put him feet first, his head up toward the front of the airplane. This man was longer than the back of the airplane, so there was only one place for his head. That was between the two pilot seats. So we laid him in, we maneuvered him around until we got him in, him laying on his back. Now, you may not know this, but people don't pass away with their mouth and eyes closed. They pass away with their mouth and eyes open. You have to close their mouth and close their eyes. Well, sometimes, until they get to the funeral home, they don't stay closed. This gentleman, his eyes were wide open, so he was laying in the airplane, staring straight up. And I thought, well, this is okay. This is really different. I don't understand this, but we're going to have to take him home. So I closed the doors. Now, in order for me to get to the pilot seat, the door in this airplane was on the opposite side, the front door. So I went around, I climbed up on the wing, I climbed into the co-pilot seat, I closed the door, I had to climb over this man's face as he's staring straight up to get into my seat. I got into my seat, put the armrest down, kind of put my arm up. This man's head was right here, staring straight up. I didn't want to keep looking at him. So I put my arm up here, cranked up the airplane, I took off, I leveled off, I don't know, 4,000 feet, I think. I was flying along, kind of a hazy day. It was hot. I had an orange juice in the can. I was drinking it, and I was just relaxed. I had the autopilot on, and all of a sudden, something brushed my back. And boy, you talk about one pilot coming up out of the seat. I almost ripped myself in half with the seat belt. I threw orange juice all over the area. I looked around. I thought this man had come alive. I don't know what happened. To this day, he hadn't moved. I don't know if he'd moved or not, but he wasn't moving. I was sure glad. Anyway, when I got home, I had a serious talk with my business partner. And the poor man laughed so hard, I thought he was going to explode. He knew all along what was going on. But I learned, I wanted to be chief pilot. I wanted to be chief flight instructor. So I had to do that little dirty job in order to get where I wanted to go. Flew many, many more of the deceased many, many more times. Never, ever flew one in a coffin. You generally don't transport people in a coffin. Sometimes in a cardboard box, but not very often in a coffin. So I tell this story because I just want you to know that most of us do have to do the dirty jobs, the little jobs, if we're going to get to where we really want to go, if we're going to help advance the cause. There are jobs that have to be done. Also, I want you to know I'm not a prima donna. I haven't only done the big jobs. I firmly believe, folks, that if you and I will just step up, you will find that there's leadership deep down inside of you. Servant leadership within each one of you. You're not in church because you're not a servant. You're not in church again just to sit there. Maybe you've discovered and you've been burned out. Maybe you don't know where to use your leadership skills. Maybe you just need to start right where you are. Now, let me give you some quick thoughts about leadership success, because how you visualize leadership success will determine your leadership ability or the lack thereof. To be successful, a person must be motivated. Remember what I read? A person must be motivated, right? I think you probably agree with that. And motivation is kind of like bathing. If you don't bathe, you stink. Same with motivation. If you have no motivation, your attitude, your thought patterns, your work habits stink. And motivation comes from three sources. Motivation comes from fear. Motivation comes from greed. Some people call it monetary reward. Motivation comes from a changed mental attitude. Motivation comes from fear, greed, or monetary reward, and or a changed mental attitude. Motivation is the spark that lights the fire of knowledge and fuels the engine of accomplishment. Motivation maximizes and maintains momentum. Find something that motivates you at your church. Something that makes you feel good about yourself. Something that you can feel accomplished at. And again, at your church, what better place to help advance the kingdom? You know, I want you to take a moment and just think about something, because I know that you're taking a risk if you step up and take one of the jobs at your church. I know you're taking a risk if you decide to get involved. But listen to this. To laugh is to risk appearing the fool. To weep is to risk appearing sentimental. To reach out for another is to risk involvement. To expose feelings is to risk exposing your true self. To place your ideas, your dreams before the crowd is to risk their loss. To love is to risk not being loved in return. To live is to risk dying. To hope is to risk despair. To try is to risk failure. But risks must be taken, because the greatest hazard in life is to risk nothing. The person who risks nothing, does nothing, has nothing, and is nothing. He may avoid suffering and sorrow, but he simply cannot learn, feel, change, grow, love, and live. Chained by his certitudes, he is a slave. He has forfeited freedom. Only a person who risks is free. Another thing, we who reach out, we who teach the Sunday school classes, who drive the church bus, who hand out bulletins, who do anything around the church that gives us the ability to watch the growth or the lack of it, we take a risk at becoming discouraged if things don't move ahead kind of in the way that we would like to see them. A friend of mine tells a great story about discouragement. It's called "The Devil Decided to Go Out of Business," and here it is. It seems that one day the devil decided to go out of business, and he decided to sell all his tools to whoever would pay the price. On the night of the sale, they were all attractively displayed: malice, hate, envy, jealousy, greed, sensuality, and deceit were among them. To the side lay a harmless wedge-shaped tool. Someone asked the devil, "What is that? It's priced so high." The devil answered, "That's discouragement." "But why is it priced so much higher than the rest?" the onlooker persisted. "Because," replied the devil, With that tool, I can pry open and get inside a person's consciousness when I can't get near with any of the others. Once discouragement gets inside, I can let all the other tools do their work. When discouragement comes, and it will, that's when attitude and your abiding in Christ have to come into play. That's when attitude and your abiding in Christ have to take hold. I could tell you story after story after story of discouragement, which could have overwhelmed me, especially in combat, when one of your best friends goes out on a mission and doesn't return. When one of your own crew members loses his life and you are the aircraft commander. Or when you take an area from the enemy and lose some of your pilot and crew member friends in the process, and two or three days later, the enemy has retaken that piece of land. I've experienced discouragement in combat, in business, in church. My wife and I had an art business. My wife, I should say, had an art business at one time. She bought and sold limited edition collector quality art. I loved it. I helped her. I loved that business. She absolutely loved it. We did well, had fun, met a lot of people, dealt with some absolutely beautiful art. And then after about a year and a half, we found out that the owner of the company that we were purchasing from had walked away with $25 million and the company was out of business. You talk about discouragement coming. It could have ruined us. It pretty well ruined us financially. But I will tell you again that attitude has everything to do with whether or not it beats you. Fortunately, I was taught at a young age to have what I call a fight-back attitude. Then as a rodeo clown, boy, you better have a fight-back attitude. And you're laying there face down in that dirty stuff. And yeah, I learned to have a fight-back attitude in the military schools that I went to. I remember one of the schools I went to, 276 men started, 73 graduated. That's Army Special Forces School. Not very many graduated from that school. Unfortunately, some of them just didn't have enough of a fight-back attitude. I fought back. I would not allow it to defeat me. Becoming a radio announcer, that jungle survival training that I talked about earlier, as a business owner, discouragement can destroy us if we are not careful. And again, folks, I will tell you, if you're not abiding in Christ, because you absolutely do not have the power alone to overcome the prince of this world and his demons. William James once said, "It is one's attitude at the beginning of a difficult undertaking which, more than anything else, will determine its successful outcome." It is one's attitude. In fact, you can alter your life and affect the lives of those around you simply by changing your attitude. So may I suggest that you do whatever it takes to develop and maintain an elevated, a positive attitude. Remember again what I read in No Excuse. When you do, the discouragement that could have stopped you will not hamper your progress nearly as much as it could have. Because discouragement cannot hang around a positive attitude and an enthusiastic person. I like to read this little book. I read it every day. Joel Osteen puts it out. I'm not promoting it. I'm not selling it. I just use it myself because every day for 31 days, he gives a scripture He gives a very positive saying about what God will do and is doing for us, and then there's a prayer. I don't advocate that you use this, but I advocate that you use something every day. Again, this takes me 3 or 4 minutes to go through this, and it elevates my positive attitude and my enthusiasm every single day. In Ephesians 6:12, we read this. Ephesians 6:12. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. You've heard this many times. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. I'm sorry. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Ephesians 6:12. You've heard that many times. Let me offer a quick prayer for all of you, because you may be struggling with some negativism, some issues of discouragement. Let me just offer a quick prayer. Heavenly Father, I ask you in the name of Jesus to give your Holy Spirit to each person within the sound of my voice, those that are in this gathering, to keep discouragement from attacking them, that you would send angels to stand guard around the mind of each person who listens to this prayer, to keep them from dwelling on Satan's gloom, and that you would send your greatest warrior angels to surround each person's family and home so that Satan and his evil warriors may not come near. In Jesus' name, amen. You are not standing alone, my friend. So don't give up. Don't quit. I don't care how dark it looks. Don't give up and don't quit. Don't you dare slack on your Christian duty. Don't allow these to go unheeded. We who are leaders, we who are servants, we who are ministers, servant leaders, servant ministers, leader servants, however you want to say it, we are the ones who refuse to quit. We get knocked down, we get right back up and keep on ticking. Again, I've seen it on the battlefield, I've seen it in the air, I've seen it in the classroom, I've seen it at home with my children and my wife, I've seen it in business, I've seen it in church. And trust me, again, there is leadership, servanthood within you somewhere. You just have to have a reason to let it come out. Your church, your pastor, keeping the padlock off the back door, keeping your pastor from becoming so discouraged, so worn out, that he has to go away. I've learned some things about keep on ticking in my life, doing some of the things that I hope you never think about doing, and being put into some places and situations that I hope you never get into. But you know what? I've learned that courage is not the absence of fear, but rather the judgment to realize that something else is more important than fear, like saving your life, or saving your church, or saving your pastor's future. I'll tell you a little story again. I hope you don't mind some of my stories. I was teaching a young man, how to fly. And I was flying an aircraft called a Tomahawk. It's a two-seat, got a lot of window space, pretty good little airplane. We were going out to do stalls. For those of you that have never flown, those of you that have flown, you know perfectly well you didn't like stalls. Nobody likes stalls. I don't even like to teach them, but they're a requirement. You have to teach stalls. For those of you that don't fly, here's what a stall is. You fly your airplane up to a certain altitude, and You start slowing the airplane down. As you slow the airplane down, the front of the nose of the airplane comes up. Pretty soon, there's a stall warning horn that goes off. Right after that stall warning horn goes off, or at that time, you've got the airplane slowed down because you pulled the power back. The airplane is going to wing over, and it's going to kind of make a little bit of a downward, and then you bring your power back in, and it's just going to fly right off. You go back and you do two or three more of them where you just do one of these and it's very nice. You have to teach your student how to do that so they can pass their test, but also because they need to understand what happens if that horn goes off, what do they need to do? Well, we went up, we were about 4,000 feet above the ground. I like to do stalls pretty high. So we had gone up, nice clear day. We slowed the airplane down, slowed it down, slowed it down, slowed it down. The stall warning horn went off. The airplane rolled over a little bit. It should have flown itself right out. That airplane went right into a straight down spiral nosedive. I did everything I was taught to do. I did everything I had taught to do. I did everything that I could think of. That airplane was spinning straight down, straight down, straight down, straight down. After a while, I said, "We're dead. I can't do anymore. I'm waiting for those trees to come up through the front of this airplane. I don't know what to do." About 1,000 feet above the ground, that airplane flew itself out, leveled itself off. I put the power back in, and we were okay. Sweating profusely. But I thought, because I remembered when I was a kid and we were riding horses, someone got bucked off the horse. We always said to them, "Look, you got to get back on and ride again." You've probably heard this, because if you don't, you'll be afraid and you won't want to ride the horse again. So I thought, okay, I got to go back up. We got to do another one, because he may be afraid and won't want to do these, and he's got to do them, and his check ride. So we climbed back up to 4,000 feet. We pulled the power back. The nose came up, Stall warning horn went off. The airplane rolled over, and would you believe, that airplane went right on its back. That airplane's not designed to fly upside down. It went, started going down. Now, in an airplane, on the speedometer, for those of you that don't fly, there is a red line. It's kind of like the tachometer in your car. The speed of that airplane, if it gets into that red line, it's dangerous. If it goes above that red line, things start falling off of the airplane. Things like the wings, the tail, all those necessary items. We were at red line. I said, "Curtis, you had your chance. You shouldn't have come and done this. You could be back in the barn drinking coffee and telling war stories, and here you are. Now you're going to get killed." Would you believe that about 1,000 feet, that airplane flew itself right out of that thing? I believe that one of those warrior angels came along and helped us get out of that. I flew that airplane back to the barn, as we call it. I haven't been in one of those airplanes since. But the judgment to realize that something else is more important than fear, going ahead and doing what has to be done to make sure that you get the job done. Something is more important than fear, your fear, your future, your church's future, the future of your pastor and the body of believers that you worship with. Sometimes you and I just have to decide to make some serious changes. Just work through the fear. Sometimes it's up to you. Not the person sitting next to you, but you. Sometimes you have to do what's really inside of you, even though it may be uncomfortable at first. If you take one of these jobs, it may be uncomfortable at first. Every job we take takes a little while to get into it, but you'll get over the fear. You have to let the leader, the servant, come out, because that may be the only way that your church survives, the only way that your pastor will survive. Your fellowship, being your church, is the place God designed for you to discover and develop and use your gifts. Now, again, you probably have a job, a family, you go to school, you have friends, you have things that you do. You may have that loved one at home that's ill, you may be retired, you may be a single parent again. And I know that you don't have a lot of time. But as members of Christ's body, we are His hands, His feet, His eyes, and His heart. He works through us in the world, and we each have a contribution to make. Now, again, you may not be able to do the heavy lifting. You may not have much time, as I said, You may not be strong enough to do some of the jobs required. But again, you can pray. At our church, we have what's called a monthly prayer calendar. I really like this. Every day, day 1 through day 31, this gives us something to pray for. The first day is a family in the church. The third day is our worship services. The sixth day is a family in the church. The 12th day is youth and children's ministries. The 16th day, church building and property. The 19th day, a lady in our church. You might consider this. It reminds you of who to pray for and what to pray for, because if you can't do anything else, you can certainly pray, but God wants us to pray specifically. And I know that you have dozens of hidden abilities and gifts that you may not know you have because you've never tried them out. So why not try doing something that you've never done before? But don't try to figure out your gifts before you get involved in serving. Just start serving. Many of us have discovered our gifts when we stepped up and got involved in some ministry around the church. Try teaching or welcoming or cleaning or organizing or playing an instrument or working with the young children. Read a book to the kids in Sunday school. You may never know what you're good at until you try. And you know what? If it doesn't work out, call it an experiment. Not a failure. That was an experiment. But you'll eventually learn what you're good at, and you'll be helping your pastor and your church. You'll open the doors to yourself, your church, and some service that needs to be done. Because it may very well be up to you to get things started. I pride myself in the fact that I have never gone to a church and just sat. Never. I've always been very, very busy flying, teaching flying, being in the National Guard, raising a family, helping my wife with her business, kept me very, very busy. Yet all the time, I kept myself busy doing something at the church that I worshiped in so that I could help keep that operating like that well-oiled machine that I mentioned. So I know firsthand that if I can do it, you can do it. Two things and I close. Service is the pathway to real significance. Service in your local church is the pathway to survival. Your service in the church where you worship may just be the thing that keeps the padlock off the front door. Romans 12:6. Romans 12:6. Each of us finds our meaning and function as a part of his body. Then this. If you're not involved in any service or ministry, what excuse are you using? Now, I know you've heard of all these people that I'm going to mention in just a moment. They're all in the Bible. I want you to listen to a brief resume of each one of them. And I want you to see if maybe you could put your name where one of those are. Now be careful with some of them, but let's just see if you could put your name where some of these people are. Abraham was old. Jacob was insecure. Leah was unattractive. Joseph was abused. Samson was codependent. Moses stuttered. Gideon was poor. Rahab was immoral. David had an affair and all kinds of family problems. Elijah was suicidal. Jeremiah was depressed. Jonah was reluctant. Naomi was a widow. John the Baptist was eccentric. Peter was impulsive and hot-tempered. Martha worried a lot. The Samaritan woman had several failed marriages. Zacchaeus was unpopular. Thomas had doubts. Paul had poor health. And Timothy was timid. This is quite a variety of misfits, wouldn't you say? But God used each one of them in his service. He will use you also if you will stop making excuses. Remember what God told Moses? I will teach you what to say. I will help you and teach you what to say. So take a look at the list again. Talk to your pastor or church administrator and step up to the plate. It's your turn to bat. It's time to get this airplane off the ground and make sure that it stays in the air. Don't let your church become one of the next 6,000. May God bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. Thank you.